On this episode of That Kingsville Podcast, we talk Kingsville Council news and special phone guest, NDP, MPP, Essex, Taras Natyshak. Join us, Kevinless, unfortunately, for this episode of That Kingsville Podcast. That Kingsville Podcast is brought to you by Kingsville Brewery, featuring refreshing premium beers, perfect for having a couple of pints with your pals. Crafted with natural, clean ingredients, their award-winning beer is available at select LCBO, beer store, and grocery stores. Go online to their website, kingsvillebrewery.com, and order takeout at the tap house, or have beer delivered for free in Essex County. Cheers to the everyday adventure. Thank you, Kingsville Brewery. Welcome to That Kingsville Podcast. I'm your host, Dave Hunt, and with me, Steve Iansen. Unfortunately absent from this episode, Kevin Black couldn't be here with us tonight, but big show, special guest coming up later. Phone interview with Taras Natyshak, NDP, MPP. That's a lot of acronyms.
It is.
Essex comes on with us, discuss some local events, opportunities, talks about his career, and then we discuss some of his more notable things that had happened over the past 10 years of his career.
He's had an interesting decade.
Interesting decade, yeah. You know, hey, you know, we're we're all a part of Essex County. He's been a big part of it, so it was great that he was able to come on with us. Joining us on That Kingsville Podcast, special guest over the phone today, you know, day of COVID and whatnot. We got to keep the distance. We've got Taras Natyshak, NDP, MPP of Essex. Thanks for joining us, Taras.
My absolute pleasure. Thank you so much for having me on the show.
Well, you've been the big news story around here politically over the last couple of days, which we'll get into. You know, special guest, thank you very much for taking the time out of your busy schedule to join us on this wonderful Kingsville-centric podcast. I know it's a big part of the county and all your years of service. So 2011 was when you officially were elected and started your endeavor in the area?
That's it, yeah. October 2011, after multiple attempts at the federal level.
Right.
three strikes there. I think if there's something to be said about Essex County politics, they definitely they weigh someone's persistence when they're looking at candidates. So they saw that I wasn't going anywhere. I was the perennial candidate, and they said, let's give this kid a shot. I mean, he's not going away. He's knocked on my door 25 times, and let's see what he can do. So, yeah, it was 2011. I was honored to carry the provincial banner, and that set off just an incredible, amazing career that I've been so fortunate to have.
It's been a very active decade for you. I mean, there's been a lot of changes in the area as a result of, I mean, while maybe not necessarily the NDP directly, but certainly your push and your endeavoring, if you will, to bring issues to light. One of which is Highway 3, and you know we've got a very large pile of dirt now at Victoria and Highway 3. But let's start with Highway 3 and the progress being made there, and you know your involvement initially on getting this moving forward, and what the plan is going forward.
Yeah, well, I mean, if there was ever a glaring issue that stares people right in the face in terms of priorities for our community, it was Highway 3. I mean, I don't have to tell you guys how frightening it is to take a trip on that road. So, I really am riding the coattails of my predecessor, Bruce Crozier, who the road is aptly named after. Mm-hmm. Bruce put a lot of work into, you know, identifying the need initially and getting the funds secured to be able to start the first and second phases of the expansion of Highway 3 and the doubling of it. So, recognizing that this needed to be finished, I definitely took up the mantle and was proud to do so. And it really just involved making a whole hell of a lot of noise and being relentless on the issue, which I through multiple governments, former previous Liberal and now Conservative governments, they knew where Highway 3 was, that's for sure. We didn't, let a day go by without them knowing that this was a project that needed to be finished. So in terms of my involvement, you know, my involvement is continuing on the process of advocating for a safe highway throughout that stretch until it's done. And, it's something that, you know, I won't cross the proverbial finish line until we see it fully extended and fully widened, because we know it's from Leamington to Windsor, it's a dangerous stretch in those areas that have arterial roads and arteries that connect to it that are single lane. So it was an easy issue to fight for, and you know, anything in politics, you can only achieve so much alone. I would absolutely credit this community for coming together to say, you know, there's no way we're going to accept anything except a complete widening of that stretch.
Yeah, it's such a critical and integral part of the entire community, with us being a commuter-based society, working within, you know, the city of Windsor and surrounding communities, coming from the county. All the statistics about the accidents and the deaths and the recklessness that occurred on that stretch of highway for so many years. I know I'm glad for certain, having been one of those statistics and been in an accident, that I was unscathed and alive. I'm one of the lucky ones. But the fact that now that those concerns were heard and actually executed on the action to help prevent and reduce the amount of risk that we all took, thank you for being a part of that and getting something changed for the community. So
my pleasure. Yeah.
Yeah. It's one of the small, unique issues that we have in this area. And traditionally Windsor Essex and the old adage is everything south of London's forgotten because it isn't Canada. You were one of the major vocal voices with making sure that our concerns were heard. Another one being the mega hospital. Like, our mega hospital situation within Windsor Essex is one of three feeder hospital, or there are currently three hospitals within the community with dire need to add capacity. And having the situation with that hospital, the location, all the funding and whatnot, I'm sure that was another major earmark in your career.
It was, you know, and it continues to be. Again, you know, I'm reluctant to say that my efforts on it were singular. I mean, of course, it is a massive undertaking. Right. It'll be a $2 billion project. So, you know, the need for a new hospital in our area, a regional hospital, was identified a long time ago. And I would even, at this point, I'd give credit to Dwight Duncan, who at the time was the finance minister, who definitely put it on the agenda. And it was a Liberal a majority government at the time. And, you know, we knew that that it was just something that was staring us in the face again, that Windsor in this area, in terms of its growth and its capacity and the infrastructure that we currently had with the three hospitals at the time, was something that needed to happen. The process had to start happening. But it doesn't mean that just because the government says they want to do it, they're going to get on it very quickly. I've seen way too many promises. Yeah, can you believe that? They're going to say they're going to do something, and 20 years later, it's not done. So, you know, that's where the role of opposition members and effective opposition comes into play. And so you just hammer them as much as you can into committing to their promises. And when they don't, you hammer them some more. And it's kind of a pretty easy recipe. But I'm happy with the progress so far, in that, you know, we have a site identified, we have funds allocated, recently, by the current government to start the process of the design phase and the consultation through that. That's $9 million that the Ontario government has committed to it. But I continue to remind them, that they're nearly $2 billion short. So, you know,
moved a decimal place over, did they?
Shame on me when they come out with press conferences saying, you know, we're building a new hospital, and they've really only committed $9 million out of a $2 billion and growing price tag. So, you know, it's something that you continue to apply pressure to where and when you can. But as far as I'm concerned, we not only need a new hospital, but we deserve it. And so do other communities in the province. That's you know, that's the other factor, is that there are communities that need hospitals in the north and the west, in central Ontario, that are competing with limited dollars or competing for limited dollars at the same time. So there's a little bit of frustration when, you know, there's backlash around the site. And I understand those concerns, and I've talked to many people that would rather see a regional hospital located closer to the city core for various reasons. But we have to understand that this is a regional hospital.
Right.
It has to service people from Stony Point and Cottam and Comber and Essex. I had folks from the town of Essex wanting to have it, you know, proposed in the middle of Essex,
mm-hmm.
Right. At the beginning of the phase. So, you know, I see it as a compromised site, and now it's up to us to sort of turn the page on site selection and location to what the amenities that hospital will actually have and how it will service our communities now and into the futures. That's what my focus is. Also, maybe a complicating factor is how we're actually going to pay for this thing. The province of Ontario for decades now has leaned on public-private partnerships, P3s, in that model to fund infrastructure, whether it be roads or otherwise.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a model that is contentious. I mean, it ends up typically costing taxpayers a whole lot more money than if it were financed through the Treasury or other means than putting it out for a P3 type project. So that's a whole different other fight. But as for right now, I'm certainly happy that we've got a commitment for the design phase, and you just keep battling on. You know that the fight is not done.
Going back to Highway 3 briefly, is there a timeline as to when that would be fully completed? And then as far as the hospital goes, is there a timeline for when there might be a shovel in the ground?
You know what? I'd be guessing I'd be pulling figures from the air, Steve, sure. If I was able to give you anything right now. But okay. I mean, the roadway, I'd be a little bit more closer to tell you that we're probably, 2 years away from having all the equipment off of the road and having it functional for at least the part they're working on now. But the hospital, I would imagine is a longer term. You know, we're looking 10 years down the road.
Okay. One project that is closer to home for us in Kingsville, not quite on as grand a scale as Highway 3 or the hospital, is the new JK-12 school in Kingsville. Mm-hmm. A couple of months ago, there was discussion that the money that the board provided, what was announced, 5 years
yeah,
ago?
Yeah, 5 or 6 years
wasn't
ago.
Wasn't going to be enough. There was discussion at the school board level, and the school board voted down asking the province for more funding. Were you aware of all this? Did you have any input at the provincial level to say, hey, look, this isn't coming from the school board, but maybe we need to consider 5 years on that the money allocated isn't enough?
100%. Yeah, I was in discussion with a lot of the folks on the ground, school board trustees, as well as educators and faculty in the school that identified quite clearly that the design of the new school and the costs associated with that build at that time just didn't add up. I mean, costs had already escalated, and we're talking almost just at the beginning of COVID when we started to get some hard numbers on what the costs would be. Now, given given inflation and what we've seen, sort of the supply demand side of economics and construction economics, at least, play a role in everyday materials that we need. Labor shortages, I mean, costs have only escalated in terms of what has been already allocated or budgeted. So I would imagine maybe a year ago, I fired off a letter to the Minister of Education letting them know that their numbers in terms of the budget was going to be, they were going to be way, way off.
You got your letterhead out? You might want to,
I might have to even revise. I'm probably a couple dozen million dollars short from what I even identified, what, you know, how they were sort of shortchanging their design. But those concerns have been heard. It's kind of a thing where you've identified the issue, you've flagged it for the government, and you hope that they do the right thing. If they don't, then, I mean, shame on them. The community has told them, municipality has been vocal about it, and certainly families and parents and students from that area have said, look, this isn't going to suit or fit our needs now, let alone into the future, mm-hmm. given that Kingsville is such a huge, you know, growing community. So,
complete it, with a know, podcast talking all about it. I know. Geez,
oh, there you go.
We're really growing here.
Yeah, absolutely.
Those are the exactly. That's progress of the town. That's the development of the way that, hey, 5 years ago, things weren't exactly clear as they are now. And we were afforded with COVID. And I dare I say the C word.
That, you said it.
Yeah, I did. I did. We can talk briefly about that. But that gave us that moment to pause while everybody was out of the schools. And we gained the realization of, hey, where the world is transitioning and what's happening. And that's caused a lot of pain, agony, grief in all levels of society and whatnot. And you being a politician, I'm sure, faced a fair brunt of criticism and ridicule and as part of your job in opposition, you know, spewed your fair bit out of it. Some things, you know, we heard about in the news. You know, it's something with Mr. Ford. I don't know, some unsavory commentary about something.
Yeah, I mean, we can't question your passion, that's for sure. But critics will suggest that maybe you go a little too far sometimes. how do you react to that?
Oh, are you guys referring to when I use some unsavory language in the chamber?
Yeah.
It happens, look, I guess.
Heard some stuff.
Yeah, you know what? I look back on that one. And I'm glad to be able to chat with you guys about it because it was a unique day and a unique circumstance. Doug and I have a unique relationship. he's a brawler.
Yeah.
And I don't think he ever expected to come up against the brawler on the other side quite like me. Maybe chalk that up to being from Essex County, but I don't really put up with a lot of stuff. And definitely not from Doug Ford. So we go toe-to-toe and nose-to-nose on various occasions. But on that certain day, that specific day, I was asking a question about what the province was doing to support and to protect migrant workers.
Yep.
That was my question.
Yep.
Because Kingsville at that moment, specifically Kingsville, was being targeted because we had such a massive outbreak of COVID within the migrant worker population. And there were a lot of things that the province could be doing at that time that they didn't do. We saw other jurisdictions like British Columbia, they were doing a whole lot more. They were providing housing for migrant workers coming in to be able to quarantine for a period of time before they got into the workforce. So the best practices were already clear for us, and it could have taken a lot of heat off of the town of Kingsville and the, you know, the agriculture sector there. So I asked that question, what are you doing to help us out here? And he went personal. He went at me, which, you know, on any given occasion, I don't really care. Come at me. That's okay. But it was that it was a really important question. And he went at me and I lost it a little bit. And I regret using that language in the chamber. That's the thing that kind of got to me, that I actually allowed myself to feel that, right? I typically have thick enough skin that I wouldn't resort to that. But yeah, I lost it. And some would say that my comments towards him were a little bit too generous, actually. I should have been more forceful, but, you know, I apologized right away.
Yep.
I actually had a press conference and because it, you know, it wasn't something that I was proud of. I respect the chamber. You know, it's easy to, we could yell at each other and swear at each other and even resort to physical altercations to try to solve our problems. But the legislature and the chamber is a unique place. Mm-hmm. You can only use your words to try to solve problems. And that's democracy. And I respect it so much that I really felt bad about using those words. I don't think in my 10-year career that I've ever sworn in the House, and that was the one time that I did, and I felt bad that I did it, but I know that it was for the right reason, so I'm able to come to peace with it.
Unique set of circumstances. Well,
very much.
Well, and you've been making news lately, and I'm sorry we didn't get to scoop it, but you had to go to the national media first.
Yeah.
So you're hanging up your hat. in 2022. It's over. We're done.
Or is it?
Yeah.
I mean, you're maybe done provincially, but the one article I read suggested that you may be looking to serve your community in other ways. And it is a municipal election year. So.
Yeah, yeah. There's lots of political opportunities coming up, and I'm sure well into the future. Look, guys, I'm 44 years old. I'm right in your demo, right? I'm right in the wheelhouse in terms of, I think we're all close to the same age.
Oh, you bet.
We're all Gen Xers. We all partied downtown Windsor at Bentley's and Jokers and
Spotted Dog.
The heyday of, there you go. So
I just played a gig there one time with a high school garage band. So they let us in underage. That's it's not even there anymore. But
what's just fun to play, was it not going to drink. Downtown, if it wasn't underage, why would you even go?
Well, we weren't drinking. We were just
entertained,
fortunate enough to be in a battle of the bands. Yeah. Anyway, this isn't about me and my my past.
It's the bookends to your.
I missed that.
Yeah. It's the bookends to your provincial legacy. So.
Well, you know, you do the math on it, and it's been an incredible career. It's 10 years in elected office. It's another 6 years as a candidate trying and knocking on thousands of doors to try to represent this riding. So all told, you're in the public eye for 16 years or whatever. That's at 44 years old. That's a good chunk of my life having, playing this role and being this person. And I get to a point where I see a lot of runway left, I hope, with an incredible family that I'm sure would appreciate me being home a little bit more. And opportunities to do something incredible in the future, or maybe not so incredible. I don't really know, but I do know that I'm only fulfilling my, I'm only at my best when I'm able to help people. Like, I know that for sure of myself. Anything else, if it's just selling a trinket or something like that, I won't be able to, I can't do that, but I can use this big body and this loud voice and this sort of forceful demeanor to try to fight for people that need help, and wherever that takes me in the future, I'll look for those opportunities. If it's elected office in the future, I don't know. That's I'm not going to rule it out because who knows. But as for right now, my tenure as the MPP, the provincial member for Essex, is going to come to an end, and it's been the honor of my life.
Hey,
it's such an incredible privilege to be able to do it. So. Well, I'm so thankful.
I think party politics aside, people would have a hard time denying the fact that you didn't go to bat for Essex County. Like, we knew that with you there, we were
heard.
We were heard. We had a loud voice, but we had somebody who championed our causes. That even if you had a conservative or a liberal or an independent, regardless of party stripes. If they contacted you and they had an issue, you were there to listen and you were there to bring it to the fore. And on behalf of the residents, I thank you for that.
Well, that's very sweet. Thanks. It's kind of, no, it really is. It's, I've never had so many people thank me for quitting my job. I don't know how to take that.
did you get a memo from Doug instantly? Yeah. It was like, he's not going to have to put
up. Glad to see the back of him.
I heard Doug did an incredible backflip. It defied gravity, but he's happy to see me go, which is kind of, I mean, I have no ill will towards the premier, it's something that I'm sure he understands is my job. And, if I was effective in it, then that was my only goal.
So on the way out, if he said, bygones be bygones, let's have a beer, do you take him up on his offer?
Yeah, for sure, of course. Yeah.
What if he's a Molson guy and you're a Labatt guy, though? Like, do you really crack that blue, or do you go for the Canadian?
Take him some Kingsville Brewery.
Yes, exactly. Kingsville Brewery. Delicious Kingsville Brewery.
There you go.
Sponsorship plug.
Yeah, absolutely. We got some wonderful breweries sprouting out, but definitely Kingsville. Mark Muzzin, our good friend. Who's doing an incredible job there, Marty Turco.
Great friends of ours, too.
They're putting the brand out there. We see them everywhere.
Absolutely.
So I would have a Kingsville beer. But, and I mean, that it just speaks to the term that I've had, the time that I've spent there. I've made friends across party lines. I mean, it doesn't really matter. We're all there to serve. And I know it sounds cliche, but really people genuinely are sacrificing and dedicating their efforts to trying to make their communities better. It's just the damn politics that gets in the way of it so many times, right?
But too many times.
That's it for sure. I'm sure there's a lot of colleagues that I'd love to, I'll be chatting with in the future.
Well, about, if we could ask for the scoop the next time, you know, you make a decision politically, you know, that'd be great for our little podcast. We might get like another few listeners, but no, Taras, thank you very much for spending the time with us. And, you know, honestly, as Steve reiterated, thank you for your service for the province and the local community, because of some of the things that you've been able to accomplish and all of the things that you've been working towards. There's definite benefit, and we greatly appreciate it. And thank you very much for spending the time tonight with us on That Kingsville Podcast.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. Happy New Year to you both. And thanks for doing this for the community. And thanks for your kind words tonight. It was fun.
Yeah, thanks.
Appreciate it.
Got some things happening around town, Steve. The train. That train has been everywhere in that park. You been down yet?
No, not yet. But I will. I will see. I was scheduled to work with Nelson.
Oh, yeah.
And then I received a text saying that the schedule had been modified.
Oh,
and missed then it. I was supposed to. I was asked if I could do another night, and I wasn't available that night, so I won't be working the train this year. However,
this year at all.
No.
I
know,
Steve. I wanted to bring.
I think
the whole
I jinxed
family.
Myself though when I said I wanted no. You know, I think no I've actually cursed myself by referring to the path, and you know, I'm just like.
Hey, listen, after we saw it at the parade, and I've seen everybody getting the enjoyment out of it down at the park, I think it's, you know, it's paying off. For reliability reasons. How many times did that old one break down?
Well, I mean, I've waxed lyrical too many times about, you know, that one rough season. But again, like, you know what? I was maybe a little bit harsh in my words last time, but I do want to recognize the town that they did maybe step out of their comfort zone in a way to make this purchase. And, you know, it's not going to come without criticism.
Yeah. No.
But again, the enjoyment, the fact that it's a key component of one of Kingsville's major festivals, I think is telling, and people are enjoying it, like you say. Yeah, so it's
a
great.
It's going to be a big part of the Fantasy of Lights Festival and a big part of the town of Kingsville for years to come. So, well,
and let's not forget too, is it's not just for the Fantasy of Lights. I mean, again, the previous train had been used to shuttle guests around during other festivals, whether it was when Tall Ships came, escaping me.
Highland Games.
Yes.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Can't wait for this year.
It's going to be fun.
It is.
Next year.
Next year. We're only a couple of weeks away. I've already checked in.
You're already 2022. In 2022. Okay.
Town council hasn't yet, though. They met yesterday on Monday, the 13th of December, 2021. They had a few things on the agenda. They were talking about a consultant. So motion went in front of council that Janice Forsyth of Foresight Management Consulting, contracting her services for the town to conduct a customer service review. So apparently the administration or council is feeling the need in order to continue improving the level of service for the townspeople. And they've identified the need to consider or have a consultancy service carry out another study. Now, I don't know about you. What are the pillars of customer service are response time to phone calls, information conveyed. Like, I don't know how far reaching this, but the overall contract value is $15,000 paid out in $150 per hour increments, if I remember correctly. And this passed yesterday, 4-2 motion carried. So, okay. I don't know. I'm curious to see.
Well, I guess, yeah. How far reaching is it? I mean, are we talking like, from people who are shoveling snow, cutting grass and all that, like is that fall into the realm of the customer service? Are we talking those people who directly interact with the public and only them and not anyone necessarily behind the scenes?
And forgive me, like I don't have all the time in the world to invest in watching all 3.5 hours of last night's council meeting. I do have things that I have to do, but I'm hoping that considering the amount of money and the investment and the new management that we have in place at the town, that this study is addressing a gap that was identified and not just a broad brush approach towards the overall effectiveness or efficacy. Is efficacy, can I use efficacy in that? Effectiveness. You're the journalist. You should know this. Former journalist. The effectiveness of the administration and the management at the town in order to handle the townspeople's needs. So that was one thing. So another one with regards to facilities and staffing. So there was a motion that $250,000 be appropriated to convert the Unico Center in downtown Kingsville in order to update and facilitate the planning department and a couple other departments as well, because of the additional staffing that the town has had to add to address all of these needs in order to house them, because the facility on Division Street North is at capacity or over capacity. So
no surprise there. I mean, if the town's going to grow, the need for personnel is going to grow.
Right. So knowing what the municipality has as invested properties within the community, Unico seems on surface value to be the one that we could immediately convert into cubicles and office space. It has facilities for restrooms and kitchenette, because being a former bank, it's outfitted.
Sure.
Just a matter of, you know, adding network infrastructure and any kind of desks and whatnot. And at $250,000, it's not outrageous, but it's reasonable. So when this motion went up, a lot of opposition from council.
Okay. I don't know what the opposition would be, but I'll tell you a quick story as to what part of it could be. So as far as I know, the Unico is not not a highly used facility. However, those that do use it really value it. And the reason I say that is because I was out delivering mail in Kingsville one day, and this lady stopped me and she said, I look familiar. And I said, I'm so sorry. And she said, no, how do I know you? I said, well, I told her what my previous occupation was. And she says, she's Rebecca, Lily Rebecca Lodge.
Yep.
And she said that she was going to a meeting at the Unico, and she said they wanted to move the meetings to the arena. And she said she doesn't like driving at night, which I know a lot of people don't. And she said, the Unico is okay. The arena is too far. And I'm not going to say that that's the case for everyone, but I can understand that. And I can understand people making a strong case. When you look at groups like the Lily Rebecca Lodge and some of the other groups that meet there, it's primarily seniors, volunteers, that are gathering. I know when my granddad was aging, he, you know, eventually did give up his driver's license willingly. But also there were got to a certain point where he didn't want to drive at night anymore. And so I understand that. And I think if that's part of the role, it's central, it's, you know, more direct for a lot of residents. I can see why they would be fighting that.
Yeah. And exactly. I think that's one of the minor / major issues with the Unico Center is it has a lot of purposes that a lot of different people use it for different things: showers, small events, meetings, things like that. It doesn't have the broad brushed, hey, it's the pavilion, right? An identifiable use. However, it is used quite regularly. Mm-hmm. And this is some of the discussion through viewing some of last night's meeting that was discussed by the councilors. And in order to make sure that all things were considered, they requested information about alternative locations and what that impact would have by utilizing other facilities within the town, such as the Grovedale or the Carnegie or the arena, because these are also places that staff can be facilitated at without having a major impact to the one use of that one facility in the middle of town. So they had a motion to defer. So we'll see what happens in the next quarter once that motion comes back to see what the administration says with alternatives to not appropriating the Unico Center and seeing where or what impact it would have to move some of those people throughout town.
And I can see why the Unico would also be the most logical choice from a municipal standpoint.
Right.
It's like you say, the way it's constructed and the way it's fitted.
It was a bank, right? It's a square building.
It was a credit union.
Oh, sorry.
Well, you know, some of these credit union users, they don't want to be called a bank.
We are all partners in this. Yeah, no, and it's the easiest, right? It's the path of least resistance. It doesn't have the immediate overall overbearing need like the library or like the Carnegie, right? There are so many different other things that can happen there that we need to weigh out the options of if we reappropriate this towards the facilitation of the staff, what do we lose or where can we place them to satisfy those needs without having as great an impact?
Well, there's a building at the Four Corners, I think, still for rent.
What, the chocolate shop?
The former chocolate shop.
Wonder if they left any inventory behind. Yeah, and I'll be curious to see what happens. Like, if they even lobby to rent locations within town. There are still some vacancies in some of the strip malls along Main Street. Mm-hmm. And there's some future developments that are happening around town. So we'll see. And maybe it's all entirely possible if there's room on the current property, if they want to extend or build on to the current town hall. I don't know if they'd have to get rid of a parking lot. What with the new auto parts store being built to the south of them, so.
Or purchase the farmland across the street and have
mega
bridge across.
Mega hall.
Cross division.
Where would, like we were talking about it a couple episodes ago about, you know, where would you put the police station? Where would we put a new town hall? There isn't. If we had to build a whole new town hall, there isn't a great location because of all the existing structures to locate it. It would have to go west.
Well, I guess
it would have to go west.
You could make a case that if they ever build a new school, they purchase the land of the current high school. Of a sudden, you've got something like Leamington where you have this, you know, you could roll it all into one, too. Police station, town hall.
Mega municipal complex.
Yeah, they go to Migration Hall and work out on their lunch hour and just take care of it all. I only say that because how many times have I seen staff employees running through town over the years?
Oh, come on. It's regular. That's why we love Kingsville.
Exactly.
Everybody's identical. I got spotted from a parade. I didn't tell you I got spotted. It's like, it's the parade guy. Like, no autographs, please. It was like, is that moron? Like, oh, like we're famous now. 10,000-ish views now, Gary. We're 9,500, 9,200.
Yeah, 92, 9,300. Oh,
that parade just keeps on giving.
They're not watching us, though.
No, they're not. They're watching the floats. It was all about them.
But they have to listen.
They do. to our savory
There's no
tones.
Mute.
No. Lastly, big note from council last night, 183 Main East motion was to designate it as a heritage property, and town had contracted Letourneau Heritage Consultancy. I'm probably misconstruing the name of that that organization, but they identified 16 points that 183 identified as heritage content, and these were the recommendations that because this property includes those, they recommended it being designated as a heritage property, and that went up for motion, and motion was passed. So we'll see where this is now a chapter into the storied past of this property and what happens in the new year as that continues to go. So, you know, it is Christmas. Things are kind of winding down a bit, although, you know, with the state of everyone and Omicron. What's the next one going to be named?
Oh, jeez. Let's hope there isn't one.
I hope not. But, you know.
Although things are ramping down a lot of ways, but I tell you, it's budget time.
It is budget
time. It's coming up. So we'll have some good stuff coming in January once the budget deliberations start. Yep. And actually, the County of Essex is passed there, so that's something we'll look into.
Leamington just passed theirs.
For our next episode.
Yeah. So, you know, for everyone that's still listening into the podcast, we've enjoyed doing this podcast, and I know I speak for Kevin as well. Unfortunately, like we said, we couldn't be here, but these are the things that we like to talk about amongst ourselves, and we like the fact that you like to listen to us, and you know, we want to continue to give you the same level of information and whatnot. So thanks for participating along with us, and thanks for the suggestions as you see us around town or you reach out to Steve or Kevin or myself independently, and you know, it really makes us all feel good about doing what we've done. So I want to wish everyone a Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. We'll see everyone in 2022. Thanks for joining us on That Kingsville Podcast. We'd like to thank Gary Glass of Quantum Sound Productions for producing this podcast. If you need multicam, live event, commercial video, or audio production, visit their website at quantumsoundproductions.ca for more info. This week, we leave you with a seasonal favorite from our from local music duo Mary Newland and Richard Baker. Mary and Richard spent 30 years in the music business in California. Mary singing on her own and as backup for bands like the Beach Boys, while Richard played keyboards for Gino Vannelli, Gary Wright, and Santana. We leave you with the Christmas song. Merry Christmas, everyone. Thanks for joining us on That Kingsville Podcast. We'll see you in 2022. Happy New Year.
Chestnuts roasting on an open fire, Jack Frost nipping at your nose, Yuletide carols being sung by a choir, and folks dressed up like Eskimos. Everybody knows. Bright. Tiny tots with their eyes all aglow will find it hard to sleep tonight. They know that Santa's on his way. He's loaded lots of toys and goodies on his sleigh. And every mother's child is gonna spy to see if a reindeer really know how to fly. Yeah. So I'm offering this simple phrase for kids from 1 to 92, and though it's been said many times, many ways. Merry Christmas to you. They know that Santa's on his way. He's loaded lots of toys and goodies on his sleigh. And every mother's child is gonna try to see if a reindeer really know how to fly. And so I'm offering this simple phrase for kids from 1 to 92. And though it's been said many times, have a Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas to you. Ooh, 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 ooh. Merry Christmas. Thank you very much.